Billy, if you touch them, they're falling. I stand firm on this one. Thanks, everybody. We're going to have a few folks talk after I do as well, and they'll come right after me. Francis Wayne Alexander came from a loving family in North Carolina. They moved to New York. Wayne, as he liked to be called, got married. He moved to Chicago in February of 1975. He divorced shortly thereafter. And shortly after that, no one heard from Wayne again. His family thought that he wanted to be just left alone. There was no missing persons filed, nothing. We're here today to announce that we have identified yet another one of the victims of John Gacy's massacres. And that victim is Wayne Alexander. Wayne's family asked me if I could read a short statement here. This is from his sister and from his mother as well. It is hard even 45 years later to know the fate of our beloved Wayne. He was killed at the hands of a vile and evil man. Our hearts are heavy. Our sympathies go out to other victims' families. Our only comfort is knowing this killer no longer breathes the same air as we do. We can now lay to rest what happened and move forward by honoring Wayne. We ask that you respect our wishes of privacy as we process this tragedy. I just finished talking with Wayne's mother and his sister and brother. Amazing family. Incredibly thankful for all the work that everybody did to try to bring closure here. They loved him, and they are happy there's closure, but they're obviously very sad, especially under the circumstances in which this occurred. As you all know by now, John Gacy went through the Chicagoland area in the 70s killing people. And at the end of the day, he killed at least 33 people, starting in 1972. As I mentioned to you at the beginning, Wayne came here in 75 and was only in here for a short period of time. He had the misfortune of both living in the area where John Wayne Gacy did most of his killing, where he targeted most of his victims. He also had the misfortune of also operating in an area where John Gacy targeted specific people and specific groups as well. We had been investigating this as a result of our efforts to identify the remaining eight. And we were able to piece together a lot of the different parts of this. But frankly, the DNA has diminished. It's not as good and complete as some of the other ones had been. And that's where we have been blessed with different partners who have helped us in bringing this to closure. I want to thank the DNA Doe Project, who have some folks here today who are going to speak. I want to thank the Irwin, North Carolina Police Department, who were particularly helpful. And like always, the University of North Texas Center for Human Identifications. They also were helpful. Where this all came together was, as I said, the initial work that we were doing. We had been going through the DNA. We'd been getting DNA samples sent from families all over the world, frankly, to try to help us make this match in the CODIS system. As we knew from the beginning, this would only work if, in fact, there was going to be matches, if family members had submitted DNA. In this case, the family had not submitted any DNA, and that's where the DNA project came in so helpful, because they take genetics, and they work that. So much like the Golden State serial killer, that type of DNA is analyzed primarily, usually, by people. They submit their DNA for purposes of trying to figure out their genealogy, not necessarily because of missing persons. So the DNA Project, I'll let them explain what they do, they work in that area. So that was an area that we had not been able to access before, because as we've said from the beginning, the reason we're doing this is because technology keeps advancing and techniques and tools keep advancing. And so working with them, they were able to come up with a family tree. We then took that information and we were able to work through that, get contact with family members, get DNA samples from family members, submit it to CODIS to make the match and to close out this case. It was through the hard work of Detective Moran, who's been working on this for, going on a decade now, yes, that we were able to bring this to closure. But I can't say enough to you, it was like the typical painstaking work of finding out when Wayne was last seen, tax records, parking tickets, that we were able to put this all together, combining it with the DNA. The interesting part of it was this tight timeline when Wayne had come into Chicago, and he was only here for about a year before we believe he was killed. We're able to narrow the window when we believe he was killed by John Gacy because of where his body was positioned in the crawl space. He was buried underneath an individual who we know pretty precisely when he was murdered. And so that gives us an end date of March 15th of 1977. And then we have parking tickets that go from January of 1976. So it was in that window sometime that Wayne was targeted by John Gacy and subsequently killed. And so we've been able to narrow that down. As I mentioned, we have five remaining victims. We are going to continue pressing ahead with that. We're going to utilize all these different tools that we have utilized on this. We're also going to be utilizing these tools for some of the missing women that we've been attempting to locate in a separate operation in our office as well. As the advances continue to go on, we will continue to utilize those for all of these different cases we have. So I'm ecstatic we were able to bring out some closure. It's heartbreaking talking to the family. This is the first time we actually had a parent that was still alive from one of the cases, and it was very difficult talking to her. Very, very sweet, sweet lady. But I can't emphasize enough to you, every single one of the families that I've talked to in regards to this, the three other families, have said the same thing. They desired all their life for closure. They finally got it. And they're just thankful for everybody involved. So at this point, I want to bring up some folks from the DNA Project that were going to talk to us as well.
Good afternoon. I'm Margaret Press. I'm the co-founder of the DNA Doe Project, which is a nonprofit, all-volunteer organization dedicated to returning names to victims using investigative genetic genealogy. Back when Lieutenant Moran and I were first discussing using this method in possibly generating leads as a tool to assist them in identifying some of the remaining unidentified victims here in Cook County, we settled on the John Doe known as victim number 5 based on the quality and quantity of the remaining biological sample. So it's really an honor for us to be here today to be here and to have assisted the Cooks County Sheriff's Office in bringing the name back to this young man. And now I'd like to just briefly introduce members of the team who are here with us today. There's Kevin Lord, who's our bioinformatics expert. There's Jennifer Randolph, who's our case manager. Then we have our co-lead here, Harmony Vollmer. We have Rhonda Kevorkian on the team, and then Karen Binder, who's also a co-team leader, and who's going to explain to you now how that identification was made. Thank you very much. Karen.
Good afternoon. Thank you all so much for having us. Francis Wayne Alexander was also known as Gacy victim number 5. He was born in 1955 in North Carolina. It should be known that it really takes a village to solve a case like this. Obviously, there was a lot of work done by the Cook County Sheriff's Department prior to us coming in, and we were very pleased to provide an additional tool for them. Before we get the case for the genetic genealogy, there's a lab process that the DNA goes through. First, extraction, which was performed by Estrella Forensics in California. Next, sequencing, which was performed by Hudson Alpha in Alabama. Finally, bioinformatics was performed by Kevin Lord of Saber Investigations. And then we at DNA Doe Project performed the genealogy process. Given the age of this case, the quality of the DNA extract obtained was excellent. A high-quality DNA sample with little bacterial contamination was obtained from the victim's molar tooth. Thankfully, we had several excellent DNA matches, resulting in one of our fastest leads, which we provided to the Cook County Sheriff's Department. Those DNA matches are demonstrated in the family trees to my right. Furthermore, the DNA matches in this case were all available on GEDmatch, so that was the only database used for this case. In regards to the family tree, I'll describe briefly the DNA matches relationship to the victim, as well as the amount of shared DNA. The amount of shared DNA is expressed in units known as centimorgans, and a higher number of centimorgans shared indicates a closer relationship to the victim. In this case, the highest match was 279 centimorgans. This DNA match turned out to be a second cousin of Francis Wayne Alexander through his maternal great-grandparents. Additionally, on the maternal side, there was a fifth cousin sharing 43 centimorgans. Those are both on the maternal family tree on the left side of the poster. On the paternal side, there were two key matches used. The first was a third cousin once removed at 58.4 centimorgans, and the other was a fifth cousin once removed at 82 centimorgans. Thankfully, the family's research for this case had well-documented lineages, so the genetic genealogy process was fairly straightforward, resulting in a speedy identification of a candidate that was then provided to Lieutenant Jason Moran, who then followed up to finish solving this case. We have many people to thank in this case, all of whom made this identification possible. First, Sheriff Thomas J. Dart and Lieutenant Jason Moran of the Cook County Sheriff's Department. Estrella Forensics, Hudson Alpha Discovery, and Kevin Lord of Saber Investigations for lab and bioinformatics work. GEDmatch for the use of their database. The team members, in addition to myself, Kevin Lord and Harmony Vollmer, we have Rhonda Kevorkian, Jennifer Stone Randolph, Gina Rather, and Jennifer Leakis. And finally, our generous donors who supported our nonprofit organization and GEDmatch DNA testers who made this identification possible. On behalf of all of us at DNA Doe Project, we offer our deepest condolences to the family of Wayne Alexander. Thank you.
And I can't emphasize enough to you the help of the DNA Doe Project. They're an amazing organization, does amazing work, mostly all volunteers. Who help connect the dots here. As we've told over and over again, when people have asked us why are we doing this, there is no end of when we should have compassion in law enforcement. There should be no end. And we should continue until we can identify each and every missing person that we have, whether they're a victim of John Gacy or the victim of a complete stranger or someone they knew. And so people like this organization help us get there, because we can't do it without them. We can't do it with the work from Texas. It just won't happen. But this technology keeps advancing, and as we've said before, we're going to continue to use this, because I can't emphasize enough to you, talking to these different families over these years, all been heartbreaking, but there's this sense of relief that you feel from talking to them, that they've been waiting their whole life to get this call, to have this resolved. And it means everything to him. And talking to his mom today, she was just so taken by the thoughtfulness, frankly, of all of Cook County, that back decades and decades and decades ago, her son, who she loved so much, was treated with such dignity. There was a full-blown funeral with processions and burial with headstones, and it meant everything to her. And so for all the people involved decades ago, our thanks goes out to you now, because you made a family feel much better than they otherwise would. So thank you. Jason's here as well. DNA folks, any questions that you guys might want to have?
So the well-documented lineage, meaning what, like family Bibles, or what does that entail?
Records were available.
You come on over.
How
Hi. So a well-documented lineage, what I mean by that is that records were readily available on the resources that we use, such as newspapers.com and other newspaper archives, Ancestry, and there were no surprises in the family tree as far as we could find. So that was another important thing that comes up from time to time in our cases.
Jason, could you kind of just take us through the timeline on this from when you first started with the DNA Doe folks? Can you walk us through that?
Yeah, so the first step is a biological sample. So I had removed a molar and part of the jawbone and sent it off to the lab that I had been discussing with DNA Doe Project, because the profile for conventional DNA work and the profile for genetic genealogy are two different profiles. So it's not as if we could use the profile that we have in CODIS and just transfer it over to the to DNA Doe Project. So that round of testing went on. Then after that, it goes on to further testing, as they had discussed, by some bioinformatics, and it gets uploaded, and then eventually they provided a candidate.
What was roughly the timing on that?
About 8 months.
When did you submit the DNA?
In 2020.
Can you tell us a little bit about what else have you learned about Mr. Alexander in his time in the Chicago area? Was he working somewhere? How long did he live here? Where was he living?
Yeah, so he came to Chicago with his wife at the time. He was married in New York, moved to Chicago in February of 1975, immediately after being married. Moved to the north side of Chicago on Winona Street. His marriage did not last long. They were divorced shortly after. He worked at various bars and clubs, not labor work, so that was not the association with Gacy. Really, there's no proof of life or no proof of death after early 1976, and that was sort of the key. And then we knew, as the sheriff had said, the end date would be March 15th, 1977, because the victim that was buried on top of him in Gacy's crawl space, that was when he was last seen alive.
And one other thing too, I just want to reference, because Jason and I were talking about it. He lived blocks away from where Bill Bundy lived. So one of the other two we have previously identified was someone who resided mere blocks away. Numerous other victims were in the general area too. So by and large, he lived somewhat in the area where Gacy was targeting most of his victims.
Have you come across these gentlemen before in your investigation? Has his name ever popped up before?
No, not at all. So he was never reported missing by the family. So looking at old records, offline records, to see if there was a missing persons report, or to see if he was ran by police after Gacy's killing spree, none of that, arrests, none of that occurred. When we reopened the case, we were not contacted by anybody, any family or friends. So that's why the genetic genealogy was very important here, because we would not have known of him.
What did the family believe may have happened to him? Was there any family lore, or did they ever wonder whether Gacy may have entered the picture?
Well, I mean, there was never any thought that Gacy somehow was involved in the fact that Wayne was no longer around and no one had heard from him. There was a family that loved him, but he had made decisions in his life that led them to believe that he just wanted to be left alone. That they really, it's a very loving family. As I said, Jason went and met with them in North Carolina just a couple days ago. I talked to them earlier today as well. They loved him, but they thought that he wanted nothing more to do with them. And so that's why there was never a missing persons filed, which would have helped trigger some things. But trust me, many of these other victims of Gacy's had missing persons on them, and that didn't help us too much either. So there was no specific direct connection that we've been able to connect with Gacy, other than the fact that his location where he was living was right where John Gacy was targeting people,
And there's some indications in some of his lifestyle that he may have been attracted to some of the areas where John Gacy was also attacking people.
Was the wife or ex-wife ever contacted with regards to that? I mean, just, you know, it's always been one of the things with the case, trying to understand why people wouldn't have reported people missing that time.
Yes, I spoke with his ex-wife, but they were already divorced. And he was, they were separated. She had moved back to where she was from, and then he remained here.
Mm-hmm. Jason, you talk about the time from the match availability to solving this was less than 8 hours after all of that previous investigative work. Talk to us about that moment when you got the aha and that, what that 8 hours was like.
Well, it wasn't the 8 hours for me. It was the 8 hours for the genealogist from the time they uploaded it into GEDmatch and started searching through the results, that it took them about 8 hours to learn about the Alexander family and to suggest that Francis Wayne Alexander was a candidate for victim number 5. So then they go through a reporting process, and then they send it back to us.
And then once they send it back to us, though, the one thing Jay's answering, once they send it back to us, then we have a whole process to go, because in Jason and the folks from the DNA Doe Project can attest to much better than me. It's really almost like you're talking in completely different languages when you're talking from CODIS, which is what you need to actually legally close out a case and make that connection legally. It's different language than the genetic side of it. So when the genetic side gave us now a potential person who we never had on a radar screen, that all of a sudden opened up our ability to then start doing the things that we'd been doing on all of the other cases. So without the DNA Doe Project, we had nobody. We had no target zone. They gave us that, and then it was the traditional stuff. Was he in the area? Do we have records of him in the area? All that stuff. But then Jason was able to get DNA samples from the family members then that takes it up to that next level that is then understood by people in the profession that legally now we can make this determination.
So when you get that,
confirmatory samples.
Right. So when you get that, just to sort of, I guess, put a, the needle in a haystack kind of analogy here, you finally actually have a haystack to look at, I guess.
Yeah.
Is what it is.
Exactly.
And you guys start with the needle.
Absolutely. So our thought was all along, by announcing this 10 years ago, once again, when technology had not advanced nearly where it is now, we'd get people bringing their DNA to us so that we can try to make that connection in CODIS. And that's what happened in two of the cases. But then that we were limited completely by who sent us things. What this the DNA Doe Project does is that it takes us over to here now. We're now our universe of people that we potentially can now be connecting is now expanded. So it's no longer incumbent upon us just to have this narrow group of people who submit stuff to us or people who may have already been in CODIS because of some other reason. Now it's out to here. And so it's just a tremendous help to us. And the folks there, I can't thank them enough. They've been amazing partners to work on.
So beyond, obviously, the Gacy story, Mayor Sheriff, if you can, what kind of hope does this give for other families who maybe have lost touch, maybe think that their relative doesn't want to talk to them, what have you? All those thousands and millions of missing persons cases out there.
To be honest, that was the first thing that clicked in my head, because we've been working now for over a year on missing persons in Cook County, and particularly focusing on a lot of the women, the female cases as well. And where this could help us is for bodies in the morgue, frankly, that have been left unidentified. That allows us to now sort of work those in a different way, too, with a much broader type of lens. So immediately we thought of that as an application that we're going to be applying this to as well.
So then what do folks need to do if they may be on the other end of this, if they can help in terms of the investigative process?
Well, I mean, it comes back to folks who have any belief whatsoever that they have a loved one that's missing that may have died, to submit their DNA to us. Whether it has anything to do with Gacy or not, it may solve a case that's been sitting unclaimed and someone who was buried in our indigent burial ground. We now have that in a position now where we can exhume bodies rather quickly. We know all of where people are at and all those things. So we can start going through that. So we're not even limited by the recent cases in Cook County that are missing. We can go back much further, and we'd like to. And Jason put together a protocol quite a bit ago with the medical examiner for this very purpose. With, once again, we didn't have any type of crystal ball that we knew that the DNA Doe Project was going to be there and be so wildly helpful. But we put it together where we now have the ability to find where bodies are buried, extract DNA, and begin to move on things that were seen as impossible before.
Sheriff, could we ask Karen a question?
Please.
Karen, would you just, if you would, you said it was your first hit, and I think that's after everything cooked for 8 hours in the GEDmatch system. Your first hit was a second cousin through his maternal great-grandparents, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, but you rattled off some more. I mean, you basically triangulated to a bunch of rogues, correct?
That's correct.
Would you explain, with every one you get, does that hone you in even closer to the person?
Yes. So what we really are looking for is what we call a union couple. A union couple brings together clusters of DNA matches. So I have four DNA matches demonstrated on the poster here. There were several more built out in the time that we were working on this case during that 8 hours. So what we're looking for is common ancestors between the DNA matches. When we find those common ancestors, then we know that the John Doe or Jane Doe that we're looking at is likely also descended from the same common ancestor. So in this case, we were able to find a few maternal matches in a cluster and a few paternal matches in a cluster. When their parents marry, when two descendants of those common ancestor couples marry one another, that's called a union couple. And it's very unlikely that anybody else besides the John or Jane Doe that we're looking at could be descended from that couple.
So then is it a matter of once you get that level of specificity, is that when you go to the family and say, do you have somebody that's been missing for a long time? How does that work?
So we at DNA Doe Project never have contact with the family. We always hand over our lead to the investigating agency, which is why our partnership with them is so important. What we do is we do a proof of life search. So we look at newspaper articles. Once we've identified a potential family or candidate, we're looking for all of their children, whether there's any proof of life on them after the time of death of the John or Jane Doe that we're working on.
So had you done that in this case? You had already homed in on Francis Wayne Alexander?
Yes. So we were looking for any children that could be of the target couple, which was Wayne's parents. We looked at all of their different children, and it seemed like Francis Wayne Alexander was the most likely candidate. We handed that information over to the sheriff's department, and then they followed up with the family.
In terms of the work that you do, how much of this is, if not predicated on, but helped by commercial DNA sampling systems, you know, 23andMe, genealogy, all that stuff? How much are those kinds of organizations important to what you do?
So they are important. They're an important factor. The databases that we use are GEDmatch and FamilyTree DNA. Those are the only two databases that we can access for genetic genealogy in partnership with law enforcement. So we do not have any access to 23andMe or Ancestry, which are the more leading commercial databases. However, people that have tested with Ancestry DNA or 23andMe can download their DNA results and upload to this third-party GEDmatch, and that's where the majority of our DNA matches come from.
So it's a smaller pool of DNA matches, right?
It is a smaller pool, yes. So we were very fortunate in this case to be able to provide a lead so quickly because it is a smaller pool of testers in the database at GEDmatch and in FamilyTree DNA, although FamilyTree DNA is larger than GEDmatch. It is a smaller pool of candidates, and there are some underrepresented populations like recent immigrants and people of color. And so in those cases where the John or Jane Doe is from a population that's underrepresented, it's more difficult to identify the John or Jane Doe.
So in terms of tracking down his last, Mr. Alexander's last known address, was it as old-fashioned as digging up phone books from 1976? What were the quirks there?
Well, a lot of that had to do with traffic tickets. Traffic tickets and Secretary of State records is one thing that was used to learn of an address.
So for lack of a quarter.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Can you tell, what is the status of the other five unidentified victims' DNA? Have you submitted that, all five of them, or are you kind of doing it piecemeal?
It's being done piecemeal.
Mm-hmm. What's the reason for that? Why not just do them all at once?
Well, this is our first case using genetic genealogy, so we wanted to make sure that it was effective.
Is this the thing you guys have been waiting for all along? If it, you know, really unleashed, you know, all of these unidentified cases, not just the gay people for everything going back to decades?
Well, that's the point. This is one of the newest investigative tools for investigations of missing and unidentified persons. We use, you know, human identification is typically done to scientific standards like fingerprints, dental, DNA. It's also done by circumstance, learning about the unidentified deceased, learning about the missing. So we've been using those. Those are the conventional methods. This is the new one, and we decided to use it, and it was successful.
Now that you've had success with this, are you anticipating doing all five right away, or is that just too much of a burden for the investigation?
Well, we're going to start right away.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to discuss it. We have to look and see how much DNA is available for each victim. There's some logistics involved.
And there's some other cases, too, that we have.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's not the only case.
Not just in regards to that, but with some of these missing people that we've been working on, particularly ones where we believe there may be a body that was unidentified at the morgue, subsequently probably buried in... out at that one cemetery, those are cases that are really high on the priority list as well. So the Gacy case has always been something we've been working, but I've got these other missing person cases. We have hundreds of other people in Cook County missing, and that doesn't mean this type of technology is going to help in all of those cases, but for ones where there's an unidentified body that was found, this could be really helpful.
Tom, did the family indicate whether they may want to reclaim the body?
The family has been, as you can imagine, shocked by this, and they wanted to specifically take some time to think that element of it through, but they definitely, when I was just talking to them now, they were planning on coming here soon, but they were, the Chicago weather was something that led them to think maybe spring might be better. And I thought that might be a good idea because they were going to drive from North Carolina here as well. So they're definitely coming in the next few months, but it'll probably be more like in the spring. And from at that point in time, there'll be more of a determination made whether or not they want to leave Wayne here where he was buried or take him back home. Once again, they were just really incredibly overwhelmed talking about how well this unidentified person who turns out to be their son was treated by the people in this county. They were just blown away. Jason brought photographs of like the procession and all the vehicles and all the rest of it, and they were just really taken aback.
Jason, you made the notification. Can you talk a little bit about telling them this news and what the reaction was?
Yeah, I mean, I always said death notifications are one of the hardest parts of being a detective. You know, there's no good way to do it, and it doesn't matter if it's someone that died yesterday or if it's someone that died 45 years ago. It's very sensitive, and it was no less with this family. And they had five generations in one room. They all waiting to hear some news about their missing son and brother and uncle and all that. So it was... sensitive, it was emotional, but at the end, all the family agreed, and everyone that the sheriff and I have identified, whether they were a Gacy victim or not a Gacy victim, every family has said it's better to know than not to know. And it's one thing that we took into consideration when we decided to reopen the case. Are we causing more harm by doing this? And every family member we've met with, every family we've helped, overwhelmingly said, it's better to know than not know, even if the news is your loved one was killed by an evil man.
I have to drill down on the parking tickets one more time. Were those
traffic tickets.
Traffic tickets. were the actual tickets in boxes in a warehouse somewhere, or have they been digitized?
It was digital printouts of his file number and the citation code.
Gotcha.
For what it was.
So the actual ticket?
No, I didn't have the actual ticket.
Yeah, just a record of
the ticket. Yes.
But just to tie into where you're going, when Jason got this thing, once again, thanks to the DNA folks here, got to the point where we're getting close, we had to go back to the warehouse with the boxes and pull all the stuff out again and go through it because, as in so many of these other cases, I cannot tell you how many times something that was never really completely identified as what it was and what relevance it had, but was found in his house, if it had any relevance, how many times that turned out to be like wildly relevant. It was like, well, my God, that was his wallet. So we were, Jason was back at the warehouse again too, pulling through all that stuff because we were sort of hoping that maybe there had been something there. We didn't find that though, but we have in some of the other ones on things that we never thought were going to be connected.
Great, thank you, Ivory.
Thank you. Good job, bud.
Well, there you have it. Wrapping up a press conference from Cook County Sheriff Thomas Dart. This related to a new, or rather another victim of the John Wayne Gacy murders identified. So that we had heard that this was coming. We weren't sure of the details, how it was done, but we just heard along with all of you here on WGN News Now that this was their first time using a genetic genealogy tool that they said they planned to use again, not only for the remaining five unidentified, unnamed victims of John Wayne Gacy's murders, but also a number of other unidentified victims that Cook County has on its records. We covered here on WGN News Now the announcement of the Missing Persons Project that the Cook County's Sheriff's Office was launching, and we anticipate that they'll be using this tool along with many of those unnamed victims as well. So for those that missed a good portion of this stream, I can give you a brief recap here. Francis Wayne Alexander was identified as another one of the victims. It was victim number five, quote-unquote, in the John Wayne Gacy murders. That announcement made today. He was a North Carolina man who had moved to Chicago and was one of the victims of John Wayne Gacy, who was convicted of killing 33 young men and boys in the 1970s. Francis Wayne Alexander would have been 21 or 22 when Gacy killed him sometime between early 1976 and early 1977. They did contact the family. In fact, because of this project, they had to reach out to the family in order to obtain DNA samples in order to confirm his identity, that is Francis Wayne Alexander. And the mother and half-brother, I believe it was, did volunteer their DNA to confirm that the identity of him. So Alexander's remains were among 26 sets that police had found in the crawl space underneath Gacy's home, which was just outside the city. In 2011, it was Dart's office that exhumed the remains of eight victims, which included Francis Wayne Alexander, to work on getting them identified. At that time, they had put out their own call for anybody that had a disappearance in their family to submit DNA in hopes that that could be the missing piece to solving those crimes, to identifying those individuals. And while it was successful in three other cases, two other cases, William Bundy, a 19-year-old construction worker, was identified out of that. And then in 2017, a 16-year-old Jimmy Hackinson was identified. It's only been those two up until this point. So this is now our third of those eight that had been exhumed. One of the officials there said that this was actually the first time that they had used this new genetic genealogy tool, and they wanted to confirm that it works. So this being their first time using it and getting the confirmation of identity, they are confident in the tool, and they plan to use it going forward, not only with at least a few of those other five unnamed, but again, other missing persons cases in the Chicago and Cook County area. The big break came when the Sheriff's Department teamed up with nonprofit DNA Doe Project. They're the ones that use genetic information to locate relatives of those that have been deceased and not identified. So the organization compared the DNA profile from Francis Wayne Alexander's remains to profiles on genealogy websites to find potential relatives. Before we heard from one of their experts, they were able to narrow it down to, I believe she called it a union pair, which is essentially the parents of that person. And from there, they did a proof of life searches to try and identify which child that DNA could belong to, and ultimately handed over what they found to the Cook County Sheriff's Office that was able to confirm the identity, get that match with the family DNA, and inform them of the identity. identity. So there you have it, a brief recap of the announcement made today. Here we are 45 years later, and we are still getting victims identified of those murders from the 1970s, and five more yet to be named. So we anticipate with that new tool, likely they will be able to identify others of those remaining unnamed victims, and we will be doing this press conference again in the future. Latest details, always, WGNTV.com or the WGN app. We appreciate you all joining us for this live stream as this news was breaking. You witnessed it, raw news right there as it was happening, and you saw it here on WGN News Now.